Hello, let's take a look at what we've added since the last update in February. Folder tree path highlights were added in the previous version, and this is how they looked. You can now make them look this way with thinner lines and rounded corners. Another new option makes it easier to see the line for the active tab, especially when using multiple colours. Of course, you can still turn off some or all of these lines if you wish. This next thing is most useful with layouts that open multiple tabs, such as this one. We start off with tabs showing desktop, C, D, and program files. I'll navigate through a few different folders in two of the tabs. You can now jump back to a tab's starting folder like this. Unlike a locked tab, the reset only happens when you explicitly ask for it, not as soon as you click on the tab. The command to do this is go initial dir. If you type a few letters to jump to a file name, the left and right arrow keys now move around in the file display instead of moving the text cursor. You can turn this off if you wish. This only affects find mode, so when typing paths and commands, you can still use the cursor keys to make corrections. When typing a path, you now get a drop-down showing folders which match what you've typed so far. The list also works with aliases, showing both their names and what they point to, and you can scroll through using the mouse or keyboard to select the one you need. The pop-up list is optional and can be turned off if it gets in your way. Finally, path completion now works better with very large and slow folders, and will show a busy indicator if it's taking a long time. When using inline rename and similar fields, the home and end keys now stop at the file extension the first time you push them. If you then push again, the cursor will go all the way to the start or end. You can also hold down Control to jump to the start or end directly on your first push. Embedded commands were introduced in the previous version and can now be used in more places. The most useful of these is drive buttons. On the left, I have this button with this command. On the right, I have a similar button with a similar command. The first line means that when I leave Customize mode, the button itself will be replaced by a list of buttons, one for each drive. Each of the buttons will send the left or right file display to its respective drive. You can now make those dynamically generated buttons run additional commands of your choosing, and that's what we're doing here with the second line in square brackets. After navigating to the appropriate drive in the left or right file display, the buttons will then give that file display the focus. So, I'll exit Customize mode, and we see that the drive letters appear on each side. At the start, the left file display has the focus indicated in blue, and the right file display does not have the focus as indicated in grey. When I click one of the buttons on the right file display goes to that drive, and also gets the focus if it didn't have it already. A similar thing happens when I click buttons on the left. If you dock a glass toolbar to the side of a monitor and lock it in position, the toolbar is now borderless, making it easier to use with the mouse at the edge of the screen. This is also true of transparent toolbars, and it was already true with taskbar-style toolbars. If you set a toolbar using these styles to auto-hide, it will now be completely invisible when hidden. Previously, there would still be a thin white line down the side of the screen, which was particularly visible with black backgrounds. Note that with the taskbar style, you'll still get the white line if desktop composition is disabled. We've also made it possible to adjust how quickly the auto-hide toolbars appear and disappear, and we've made the defaults slightly faster than they were. The options to show system and hidden files no longer overlap. The system option has not changed. It still shows or hides things which have both the H and S attributes. The hidden option has changed. Previously, it affected anything with the H attribute set. This meant that toggling the option to show system files had no effect unless the option to show hidden files was also on, which was quite confusing. Now, the hidden option only applies to things which have the H attribute and do not have the S attribute. When the file display is grouped, the new Collapse Other Groups option allows you to quickly focus on a single group. You can also use it on a collapsed group to expand that group and collapse all others in a single action. If you open a file context menu via the keyboard, the menu's keyboard accelerators are now underlined. This was already the case for most other menus. The font viewer has been fixed so that it responds when a different font is selected without having to close and reopen the viewer. In the Add to Archive dialog, the path field has been split into two separate fields, one for the path and the other for the archive name. This makes it easier to work with long paths and to change either the name or the path without changing the other. If you're looking at this thinking it'll make using the clipboard a pain, don't worry, we thought of that. You can push Ctrl+Shift+C in either field to copy the full combined path into the clipboard. If you have a path in the clipboard, you can paste it over the file name to set both fields at once. Copying files in unattended mode can accumulate a list of errors. In this case, I've set Opus to treat existing files as an error rather than skip or replace them. When the operation completes, you can retry or ignore the errors, but you might need to do something about them outside of Opus, or need to keep a record of them, or send a list of them to someone else. To help with that, you can now export the list of errors into a CSV file. You can then load that file into a tool like Excel. Opus has a command to set the clipboard. It's usually used to put file names into the clipboard, but you can use it with any kind of text. Let's say there's an address and a phone number, which I use a lot, and I want a couple of commands that will put them into the clipboard whenever I need them. Until now, the clipboard command could only set a single line of text, so the address example would not have been possible. Now, you can use the expand new lines argument to specify that \n in the string means a new line. I've added those two commands to my jump list, so let's try out the multi-line address. And there we go. An API has been added to allow external programs and scripts to request details of the files and folders in Opus's windows and tabs, and also to ask Opus to open and select things. If you're interested in that, check out the manual for all the details. We've made a bunch of small improvements to USB export or portable mode, but I just want to talk about one of them here. In a previous video, I mentioned that you can create a DopusData scripts directory and put files in there which will be included when you export Opus to a USB stick. In the new version, the scripts directory is copied recursively, so you can now organise the things you put in there into subfolders, and those folders will also be copied to your USB stick. Drag and drop from web pages to Opus already worked in general, but it turned out that dragging attachments from Gmail to Opus didn't work with some browsers. As you can see, it works now. So that's all for today. Remember to check the release notes for all the changes that didn't make it into the video. There are loads more. And if you haven't already, check out my older videos to learn about more new features, since this video only covered what we've done in the last few weeks. Thanks for watching.